welcome on our public lecture today with someone who is, I would say, world famous, with Werner Vogel. Before we start, Werner, and I will introduce you, I just would like to use 60 seconds, a short minute, just to tell you what IBC is doing here. As you know, who doesn't know IBC? Internet Business Cluster. Okay, a few hands up. So we have decided 2 years ago to put money into an organization called Internet Business Cluster to increase research about digital markets, e-commerce, and to provide more research and more people working on digital topics. Because we have a huge demand for highly talented, well-educated, young people like you are. And we found that universities are not providing enough nice, young, well-educated people. And it's a great pleasure you are here today and are listening to our public lecture, which is one part of our IBC commitment every year that we have this public lecture. And today, Werner is here. And Werner, I just would like to start, if I find my card, yes, here's a card, with the introduction. So you're from the Netherlands, from Dutch, you're 56 years old. It's amazing how a CTO is 56 years old. We have to discuss this. One of my first questions I will have.
I'm the oldest person in the company.
Absolutely. You have a PhD in computer science. You have joined Amazon almost 11 years ago, even more, in 2004. You are the chief technology officer. So you're running the technology, the global technology on Amazon. And you have a long number of awards. I just would like to reckon two. You have been in 2014, you got chosen to be the number one technology officer in exec rank, and you have been also awarded in 2014 in the Netherlands for substantial contribution to the US-Dutch economic relationship.
The Heineken Award.
Absolutely.
Nothing more appropriate.
So great you're here. You're also
Thank you.
You're a great friend from DLD. You have been six times on our conference. And so the first question I have, you're 10 years already working for, more than 10 years, working for Amazon. How boring is that?
It's recently a journalist asked me, so what are you going to do after Amazon? And I was shocked. What do you mean after Amazon? You know, this is there's so much innovation happening. We're driving everything so hard, and whether that is, you know, it's not just a bookshop. You know, we do so many other things, whether it's on devices, whether it's in digital, whether it is in drones these days, apparently. And whether, of course, our cloud computing division. And so the things that we're doing there is so far ahead of what everybody else is doing, I wouldn't dream about going anywhere else.
And just, Werner, to give the people a feeling how large Amazon is, how many engineers do you approximately have at Amazon?
Well, we don't break out those numbers, but we have, I think, around 125,000 employees. I'm looking at Claire. It's 125,000, eh? Yeah, globally. So 125,000 employees, but we don't break out numbers between engineers and business and things. It has to do also with the fact that Amazon is a technology company. And we happen, I always like to say, you know, we happen to do retail, you know, but we could be doing many other things. And we do, of course, many other things. And we're different from a traditional enterprise. In a traditional enterprise, you may have an IT department or a development department. But in case of Amazon, all of these things are integrated with each other. Business and IT are deeply integrated with each other. And so many teams will have both business people as well as engineers. And so these things are not broken out into different silos.
But it's probably not wrong to say that you have five-digit numbers of engineers and technical people. And my question to you is, how do you coordinate those kind of troops working in several departments, working on several platforms or projects, working on advertising businesses which are built in the Amazon platform? How do you coordinate all the thousands of engineers?
I don't have to coordinate those. As I said earlier, everything is sort of is integrated into the business unit. So we're a very decentralized organization. That, I don't mean physically decentralized, although we have offices around the world and things like that, but we are a very autonomous company with very autonomous units that are very small. Often we strive for teams that are not larger than 10 to 12 people. And they're multidisciplined. Yeah, there's engineers in there, there's designers in there, there's business people in there. And as such, they fall into the particular business units that they're part of, whether that is retail or whether that is e-commerce platform or cloud computing or Kindle or things like that. And as such, I don't oversee engineers. I mean, my task is much more the technology direction. I mean, how do you strategically use technology within the company and things like that?
Okay, but just to understand how it works at Amazon, if you have, for example, the Amazon platform and you have dozens of teams working on one project.
Hundreds.
How do you make sure that from a customer-driven point, if I'm a customer and I am a prime customer, that I get a perfect product that feels that you merge all the different projects together in one product, which I love? How's it working?
Well, I don't know. I think we're getting better at it, but Amazon's homepage used to be pretty chaotic. Yeah, and I remember in the earlier days, at one moment, you know, when Google became bigger and things like that, people really loved the white space homepage of Google. We thought, well, maybe we should introduce more white space as well. And immediately orders started dropping because nobody could believe that this was Amazon. Yeah, and so it has always had the feeling of sort of this chaotic marketplace where you have all these products around and where, of course, we give you better recommendations than you would get in a normal marketplace. But as such, there's a lot of autonomous work happening which doesn't necessarily require global coordination. Organizations that are based on top-down organizations at our scale are totally hampered in their execution. And so you need to go to a much flatter model where you move decision-making to the edge, where teams are really really responsible for their, say, the yearly goal, yeah, to achieve. Let's say your recommendation engine for shoes, your goal is to build better recommendation algorithms such that it minimizes the returns. And not because returns are bad for business, it's because minimizing the number of returns means that customers immediately bought the right shoes that they wanted to have. Yeah, and as such, each of those teams have their own goals and they can move towards those goals themselves without having to have global coordination. Global coordination kills speed of execution.
But just to understand, I spoke to 5 Amazon executives before when I prepared that interview. And everyone told me that they are sometimes in a conference called Jeff Bezos in and saying, I want to have that way.
Well, you know, in general, he's right. I haven't been in that situation, though we work together a lot, but he's, of course, he's a visionary. And as such, I think he has great instincts and also a great level of experience, of course, in making the right decisions. And you know, what you have to realize is that Amazon is a company where each business unit is focused on innovation, driving innovation. In the digital world, actually, I think probably in every type of business, if you do not innovate, the likelihood that you're going to be disintermediated over time is highly likely. And in digital world, it's even worse. You know, if Amazon would stop innovating, you can bet that within a number of years, 4 or 5 years, there will be other e-commerce companies that will be taking over Amazon's role. Yeah, if you do not, and that is also the reason why we continue to invest in innovation in Amazon, because we're not there yet. And as the title of DLD this year is, oh, it's only the beginning. At Amazon, we have this saying, it's day one. And even after 20 years, Amazon is now 20 years old this year, it is still day one, because we've got still so much more stuff to do to serve our customers. Mm-hmm.
And you have acquired in the last year since 1998, 46 companies. How do you have integrated those companies? How do you do post-merger integration? Is this the same what you're saying, that they stay independently and do the thing?
Yeah, well, I think we've learned our lesson from the 1990s, acquisitions, where we try to integrate them, and I think most of those integrations fail. And I think that's a sort of a general comment that I can make. In the case of the new acquisitions that we've done, let's say since 2000, we leave these companies to be independent, to work on their strength, Yeah, instead of making them Amazonian strength, we allow these companies to build out their own strength. Look at IMDb, for example. You know, who doesn't use IMDb as being the main data source? Or who doesn't use DP Review if they want to buy cameras? Yeah, and it's not that we turn DP Reviews into an Amazon shop. It is really still trying to drive very high quality content there such that customers can make the right buying decisions. And sometimes the right buying decision is not to buy something. And that is okay. Because I think in a world where customers have access to perfect information, it is important that you help them make the right decision. We're no longer in this world of secondhand car salesmen where the only thing that you care about is making this one sale. Yeah, and after that, you don't care anymore. No, you're looking for a very long-term relationship with your customers. And for that, sometimes helping them make a negative buying decision is the most important one. I remember that Jeff has one of these letters on the walls, I believe, from one of the publishers in the early days when we just launched reviews. I mean, now everybody has reviews on their websites and things like that. But this was something that Amazon pioneered. And I remember that he got an angry letter from a publisher where the publisher said, "Don't you want to sell books?" Yeah, and the answer was, maybe if it's a bad book, maybe not. Yeah, and so it's helping customers make the absolute right decisions.
Mm-hmm. If you see your relationship with Jeff Bezos, how many times do you see him in a month or talk to him?
Well, I'm on the road most of the time, so I think, you know, we are a very decentralized organization, and as such, you know, you don't need to necessarily meet face to face to actually be able to collaborate.
And how many topics do you have usually in a year where he overrules you?
He never overrules me.
Okay, that's a clear statement.
No, I think these things are, I mean, we're not an organization like that. We're a very collaborative, fast-moving organization. And as such, I think everybody brings their own expertise to the table. And that's greatly respected. I mean, he's a... One thing, advice I can give you, if you want to be a CTO, don't go and work for a CEO that has a computer science degree. Yeah? I didn't know that beforehand, but so in general, you know, if he has a different opinion, it's probably because he's right.
Okay. What are you doing? I mean, you have tons of graduates from Stanford, from Karlsruhe, from the world-class universities, engineers, University of Munich, hopefully, coming into your organization. How do you personally keep up with the youngsters who are fast-moving and on competition all the time?
Oh, you stay young at heart. No. I think There's a few things that you need to do to actually maintain your own professional skills. First of all, I think the world of, especially technology, is moving really fast. Yeah, and as such, you really need to set time aside to make sure that you continue to hone the skills that brought you to the place where you are. And so I religiously take one afternoon off where I focus on actually learning new technologies. That might be learning a new programming language, learning new libraries, experimenting with new operating systems, building stuff against our own systems, for example. If you don't continue to do that, it's very hard, I think, to continue to gain to have the respect of your engineers. And so given how flat we are as an organization, it's important to be able to continue to talk the language that your MPE is talking as well. And the only way to do that is to be like them.
Mm-hmm. And if you look at the people you get in the company, the talents you have, what is the key criteria Amazon has for its new employees they look for?
Customer focus. And that may seem like a sort of a marketing trick. So Amazon aims to be the Earth's most customer-centered company. Yeah, and that means that everything we do is focused on customers. We also organize our whole organization as well as our technology such that teams that work on pieces are actually directly involved with customers. So it means, for example, we don't have an operations department. Yeah, operations department means that in many other organizations, you have here a group that develops software and then they give it to the operations guys to run it. Yeah, no. In our case, you build it, you run it. You're responsible for completing for that service that you run, which means that you're also in contact directly with your customers. And your customers can be internal customers or they may be external facing customers. That means that you are continuously aware of how your products are being used and also what kind of failures there are. You know, there's no bigger motivator to fix your bugs than being woken up at 4 a.m. in the morning by your beeper. Yeah, that means that you're going to fix your stuff really, really quickly. And that drives a motivation to be really customer focused. And so if we look at incoming engineers, we really look at, do you understand what it means to be customer focused? Can you actually drive that? That definitely. I think ability to work in teams. Teamwork is definitely important. So I actually often look at, if we look at resumes, engineering students especially, have you been involved with some open source project? You know, because often the kind of things that you do at school, they may be teamwork, but often things are, it's very loosely coupled teamwork. Yeah, have you been involved with some open source? Have you worked on other projects? Have you knowledge about these kind of things? Yeah, can you demonstrate to us that you're actually able to work in a team and that you're able to communicate well? Because I like to believe that engineers, you don't only need to be able to build, but you need to be able to communicate as well. And especially if you're in such a small team, you know, communication becomes crucial.
And then we have many people who have a business background here. Mm-hmm. So today some people say you need coding and you should know, even if you study something else, you should have the ability to code software. What is your view on that?
Well, I think, you know, I think having insight into how software is being produced is
an advantage.
If you want to work in a digital world, it is really important to understand how many of the components that you're going to use are actually being produced. I think that gives great insight. I also think that, for example, in a world where analytics becomes increasingly important, it is important for you to be able to use those analytic tools. And often in these analytics tools, the way to use them is in a sort of an iterative approach. Yeah, you ask a question, you refine the question, and that is actually already some sort of programming. Yeah, even using Excel. I mean, Excel is one of the big programming engines. Yeah, being able to use Excel really correctly is actually a bit of programming. And so I think a lot of programming comes back in sort of daily life of everyone in the future.
But you would say, precisely what you're saying is, if I know how software is developed, how the processes are, actually for someone who has a business degree, that wouldn't be a disadvantage at working for Amazon.
Oh, no, absolutely not. It would be an advantage, of course. Yes.
That's
what also, but it also goes for, think about all our warehouses. Think about how goods are being laid out. Just knowing how such a warehouse actually works is, of course, to an advantage if you need to operate in a world where actually the warehouses are part of the whole chain. Understanding how supply chain works is important. Understanding how fraud management works is to an advantage. And so also thinking about, for example, in the world of, I mean, fraud in any kind of digital economy is, I won't say rampant, but it is there. And as such, understanding how, what's the role of fraud prevention or investigation and how that happens in an automatic fashion and what are the kind of parts that are still sort of human driven are, I think, crucial in understanding what the overall business is.
Okay. I would like to shift the topic to the discussion we had on your last panel a few minutes ago on data. You have a tremendous amount of data. If you have a good customer like me who buys a lot, my family buys a lot. If I see your recommendation system sometimes, what the system recommends to me, I have a feeling this is web 1.0.
Well, as always, we could do better. Well, I think one thing that I actually always wanted in Amazon, and I don't know why we have never done it, is actually the ability to create roles. Yeah, sometimes, I mean, when I shop, especially when my daughters were still in college, I would buy their college books, which means that then for 6 weeks long, I would get recommendations
Precisely.
About drama books.
Absolutely. Yeah?
And so the ability to shop in a particular role and then associate, let's say, your recommendations with that would be better. Let's put it like that. If you know Netflix just introduced roles as well. Because often Netflix accounts are shared among a family, And that would mean, in my case, that I would get recommendations for all Orange is the New Black, which is not my kind of thing. And so now they have roles, so you can actually have your recommendations based on the individual who is actually watching. And I think that's something that, you know, we might do that in the, somewhere in the future. Personalization is extremely important. I think, and not just on Amazon, I think in the digital world where it is really important, where, you know, there's an abundance of products in the market, there's increasing competition, there's more consumer power in choice than ever. You know, in the past, you would be a customer of your bank forever. Yeah, I think, who here lost their bank? Well, yeah, nobody.
Okay, that's one. Several times changed.
But no, I mean, it's now, this is something that you may switch over time. If and definitely, if you talk to the folks that are in the financial services industry, they expect a revolution to happen in the coming 3-4 years, where banking is going to be radically different. And it's going to be much easier for customers to switch banks, for example. Or switch mobile providers, or switch telco companies, or things like that. And so, which means that customers are in control suddenly. That's not something that they were 10, 15 years ago. And so in that particular world, it is, as a company that offers products, extremely important that you understand who your customers are. Yeah, and not just at let's say, the cost, what they often call customer segmentation, not in big blocks, but actually really to the individual. Being able to personalize your service or your products for individuals is key in actually being successful.
Can you just explain how you, for on a non-tech description for all of us, how you analyze, store, and work with the data you get from your customer?
On a non-technical level, well, you
at least give it a try. How's it work? Do we have tons of analysts who sit over the data
streams?
No.
All of this is automated, of course. Yeah, I mean, at our scale, you cannot have, let's say, have these things be manual processes. Yeah, and so that's also one of the reasons why sometimes sometimes, for example, our recommendations fail, because this is really a case where bigger is better. The more data you have, the finer grain the result is going to be that you can produce. Now, that means if you don't have enough data, then sometimes the results are horrible. You know, and especially if you look at some of our more exotic products where there is no, people haven't bought that much of them, then sometimes the recommendations go completely wild. Go to your favorite search engine, type in funny Amazon recommendations, and you will find all the cases where a recommendation engine fails. And mainly because there's not enough data. Yeah, and I have a few slides on that where there's a famous case where someone put a set of Japanese steak knives on their wish list, and we recommend that they buy a copy of Windows 7. I don't know which one you would want to commit suicide, but, you know, or, you know, someone buys an oil filter and we recommend that he buys an album of the Jackson 5. And so sometimes, you know, recommendations go wrong. And why? Because there was not enough data to actually make the recommendations. What we should maybe do in those cases is not give a recommendation. Yeah, but so sometimes these automated processes go slightly haywire. But I think most of our customers love this kind of stuff. You know, they love a bit of funkiness around the edge.
And if you think about data protection, and this is the only question I have about data protection, you know, we are pushing very hard, Brussels, Berlin, and also Munich, that we get one level playing field about the same data protection laws in Europe. For all of you who are not aware about the topic, if you are an American company, and I use now LinkedIn, for example, they have an office in Ireland, and they have a totally different set how they can use your data throughout Europe compared to a company like Xing, which I'm heading for, and which has to use German high standards on data protection. So my question, I'm very positive that we will have a level playing field in data protection at the end of this year. How able is Amazon then to cope with this new legal playing field?
Well, first and foremost, the protection of your customers needs to be your first and foremost concern at all times. You cannot do business on the internet and not make security your number one priority. And it has been our priority forever. We take the privacy of our customers extremely serious. I actually think that we may have not have to make any modifications, neither to our systems nor to our processes, to meet any regulatory requirements in that sense. I like to believe that our standards that we have internally are much higher than any data protection act out there or that will be created.
So you say that's no problem. If the European Commission will establish new rules for all companies, you can adapt them easily.
Protection for our customers is our first and foremost concern. Yeah, those standards need to be higher than what any regulator will set, and we've pushed that forever. For example, it's also in our cloud computing division the case. Yeah, many people talk about sort of the post-Snowden area where maybe people are looking somewhat suspicious at American cloud computing companies. But what has actually has been the case is that it's been a great help for us, because in a number of years ago, when I would be talking to, for example, German companies or other companies in Europe, they would take security and encryption and things like that. They would think about it, but they would not really consider it truly serious. Post-Snowden area, it's very easy to have these conversations with your customers, because they really understand that they need to protect their data. They need to protect the sensitive business data. They need to protect personal identifiable information of their customers. And they have to start to understand that we actually give them the tools to really protect their data in a way that they are the only ones who decide who has access to the data. Not us as providers, not the American government or the German government or whatever. It is the customer who has total control over their data and nobody else has access to them.
Yeah, I think, Werner, we both had the discussion 2 years ago in Seattle about the security with your team. And let's say it that way. I'm very happy that you are now building a data storage in Frankfurt. That was part of our discussion 2 years ago, that we want to have a secure standard, and that we're very happy that Amazon, and we are a big user, as you know, from yes. AWS, yep. with several services, that you have now a company here, or not a legal company, yes. but a data
center? Yeah, we have what's called a region. It's a group of data centers, of course. I mean, people need to be able to build highly available applications. Remember, actually, from my point of view, the rise of the Frankfurt data region is much more driven towards lower latency for customers. And the fact that they can build, let's say, highly available applications across the other European region that we have in Dublin and here in Frankfurt. Because from my point of view, customers, and we've had this in the past, I think there's a document that we've created based on the Datenschutz law, exactly how to meet the requirements of the law by using AWS services, but by using them in Ireland. And so you can actually meet all the requirements of the regulator while actually running in our island region. It's not necessary to specifically run that here in Frankfurt. Of course, many German companies, if your customers are here in Germany, you would like to run that in Frankfurt because it gives you much lower latency and much better access. But it's not necessary to run your services here to meet the requirements of the Datenschutz law.
Yeah. I would like to shift the discussion a bit to questions about search. I had a meeting with Enrique de Castro 3 years ago, which you know was in charge for Google's search business for the Salesforce, and he told me that he will hunt down every company and they will reduce traffic which has more search queries than Google has. And Amazon has, in certain categories, like consumer electronics, as far as we know, 2.5 times the number of search queries than Google has. And that is official data given by McKinsey, and it's not only in consumer electronics, it's also in many other fields. If it comes to buying something, and there is a price tag, as far as the data from McKinsey shows, it's something below 300-400 euros, depending on the city, the country where you live. People tend to use Amazon first and then Google. How do you see Google as a competitor, or aren't they?
Well, we're not, as a company, not competitor focused at all. We're consumer focused, we're customer focused. We believe that if you deliver the absolute best service for your customers will come to you. Now, on the case of search, the larger your catalog is, the higher the likelihood is that your customers will find what they're looking for. And so instead of using a generic search engine, whatever that search engine is, I mean, there's many of them out there, of course. Instead of doing this two-step thing, Why don't you just go to the place where the likelihood that you can find a product with high quality information, high quality product information, with reviews, and all sorts of other things, why don't you go there directly? And as such, I think many of our customers are, or many people are coming to Amazon first if they want to search for products. Now, very important, of course, from our side was that we had to build the world's largest catalog. Yeah, that we don't only have the goods that Amazon.com sells on Amazon, but also all of the third parties that bring their products to Amazon. And we also have a third category now that is actually where we do a sort of product advertisement, where we allow items to be inserted into the catalog where we will send you to another website to purchase them there. So that allows us to have almost all the product information in the world available for our customers. And as such, it's only logical that then they would go to Amazon first if they want to search for product information.
Okay. Any questions out of the audience? Anyone having a question? Please raise your hand. And the one who raises his hand first can have a beer with me afterwards, or with Anna. We both have one. So, question here.
I have a question. Maybe you could tell us. Hello?
Yeah.
All right. Maybe you could tell us a little bit about the challenges you have in hardware. On one hand, you have a wonderful product, which is a Kindle, which serves basically all the needs that the user could possibly dream of. And on the other hand, you have a phone which has been less successful. I'm not going to ask you what went wrong, but maybe you could tell us why isn't it really good?
I don't know enough about the phone to actually tell you for what went wrong there. Okay. But I'm willing to talk about a whole other area of hardware that we are involved in, which is actually building servers in our data centers. Yeah. So at scale,
he had a question. Come on, he had a question. Just give him. Can't answer that question. Is that what he's saying?
Well, no. Oh, wait. You weren't finished with your question yet. So what went wrong with the phone is an answer that I can't answer that question because I don't know the answer.
Okay.
But you wanted to say something about the service.
But no, because when you said I want to talk about hardware, and if I think about hardware, I think about something very different than, let's say, the Kindle devices. At scale, you're going to build your own hardware. Yeah, and so if you look at, we have in our cloud computing division, we have 11 regions around the world. And each of those regions consists of what we call multiple availability zones. So an availability zone may actually consist out of multiple data centers. And so on a daily basis, we are adding as much capacity as the whole of Amazon had in the year 2004 when I joined. This is what we roll in on a daily basis. And to be able to do that, at that scale, we're able to actually use economies of scale by also designing our own hardware, by designing our own networking, all of these kind of things to build out this worldwide capability. It also allows us then to use economies of scale to drive costs down. So since we launched our cloud computing division, we've lowered our pricing 47 times. And so instead of when normal IT production would be like you would pocket that money. Yeah, most of these traditional IT companies run at 60, 70, 80% margins. And this whole cloud computing world has completely destroyed that high margin business and put customers in charge. So we're very happy with letting this be a high volume, low margin business. But we be able to actually drive the cost down by actually sort of at scale build these hardware environments. Mm-hmm. I know that was not the question you wanted to ask, but I think it's
important information. Any further questions?
Thanks for coming today. From what I understand, Germany is the second largest Amazon market outside of North America. That's what I've read. I'm not sure if it's true.
Okay.
Or not, to be honest.
Could be.
In any case, I just wanted to ask Amazon.
Okay.
Okay.
I think you have the choice. I'm surprised. I'm a user of your product.
So I don't know, but let me put it like this. We're a company that lives and breeds what I would call a sort of this iterative approach, yeah? Where you launch a service or you launch a product, and then based on customer feedback, you continue to iterate and improve the service. Yeah? And I assume that if there is sufficient feedback about this, that we will launch, we might launch titles in other languages as well. Coming from a country which, I mean, Netherlands, nobody else speaks Dutch. So, my English got a lot better by actually watching English television. Yeah, and I think in a number of European countries where everything was dubbed, whether it's Germany or Italy and Spain, see the normal countries, that it's much harder to learn foreign languages. So I think it is important to have this available in multiple languages. But that's a product decision, and I'm not at all involved with that product here in Germany. But I would expect that over time we would actually deliver these kind of things in the formats that our customers want.
Question over there.
Oh, hiring. Whether I could say something about the hiring process.
Was this a question? Was this?
Yeah. Yeah.
What do?
The front end side. What would you mean by that? No, not just engineering. I think in that sense, our process. So there is something called the Amazon Leadership Principles. Type it in your search engine and you'll get. You move to the recruiting website, and it gives a list of 14 principles that we think are important for anybody that we hire. And so, or anybody that works within Amazon, even after you've been hired, you will be sort of evaluated on a yearly basis on those 14 principles. And it has to do with things like customer focus, a bias for action, the ability to dive deep. What is it? Think big. Well, I was thinking about another one that is actually, you should not like your own smell, but I forgot what the principle is. Self-critical, yes, highly self-critical. So there's a whole range of those. There's 14 of them. And basically, when we have an interview process, there are, I would say, you get to talk to about 6 people. Yeah, there's 6 different parts of the interview. And each of those individuals will take 1 or 2 of those leadership principles. For example, indeed, the ability to think big and maybe to be customer driven. They will go and dive deep into whether or not you're able to execute on those principles. So you'll get 6 different interviews, more or less, sometimes 8. Those 6 to 8 people, the day after, or maybe the afternoon after, it's almost it's a whole day interview. And so the next day, these 6 people will get into a room with someone that's called a bar raiser. And that, in general, that person was not involved in the interview process as well. The bar raiser guards the overall process. A hiring decision needs to be unanimous. All 6 or 8 people need to vote yes. Yeah, and so often you start off with not everybody agreeing, and then you have a discussion about it that is guided by the bar raiser to make sure that, you know, sometimes a team is desperately in need of more help, yeah, and would be willing to sacrifice the bar that we've set for hiring. And the bar raiser's task is to make sure that you do not compromise that bar. The bar is set very high. And as such, I have no idea what the numbers are, but let's say maybe, I don't know, I've heard numbers for some teams that were maybe one out of 10 or maybe one out of 20 of actually interviews may get an offer. But don't hold me on those numbers, because that might be very different for different teams.
But Werner, how can you grow? I mean, you have, in this country, you don't have a reputation. Amazon doesn't have a reputation. If you see the rankings we have, where fresh university graduates would like to work, you don't find Amazon there. I don't know how it is in America, whether young engineers would like to work for Amazon. That isn't the case here. And if you say you have 10 interviews.
No. Remember that before that, there's a process called phone interviews. Yeah, so
even less arrive.
We do two. There has already been a filtering before that, where often candidates have had one or two telephone conversations with a.
But you must have hundreds of open jobs in Germany.
Well, we have tens of thousands of openings.
Do you have the number? How many?
Tens of thousands. I don't know. I don't have the exact number. No, but it is. Tens of thousands worldwide, and it's in all sorts of categories. Of course, it's engineers, it's people in warehouses, it's hardware engineers, everything across the board, MBAs. A significant portion of a team's time will be spent on hiring. It's crucial. Because not growing your team, not being able to actually grow the team to the size that you really need, is more deadly for the production. And as such, yes.
How would you describe?
But as a manager in a team, you need to make sure that the individuals on your team, the individual contributors, actually get put in a position that the interviews are not, let's say, too bothersome. Oh, by the way, people on your team will interview you, on your prospective team. It's not like HR, it is other people. It's the people that you will be working with. So what you do is, maybe it's one afternoon a week that you will be tasked, that you will be running your interviews, or maybe a day a week, such that the other 4 days of the week, you can actually be focused on your work, instead of having to have an hour here and an hour there and an hour there, that you actually need to be part of interviews.
Okay.
How do we attract them? I think these days it's a lot easier to actually attract engineers than when I joined. When I joined, everybody looked at Amazon because the only way as a retail company. Yeah, and as such, even so, before I got hired, I was an academic before I joined Amazon. I worked at Cornell as a research scientist. And I worked on very, very large scale systems and blah, blah, blah. And so they invited me to come out to give a talk about my work. And I thought, really? Amazon? What can that be? It's a website and a database, you know? I couldn't have been more wrong, yeah? And so it took a long time for us to actually break through that barrier to make people understand on the outside what kind of advanced technological work was going on. On one hand, we did that by starting to publish about the work that we were doing. So, for example, we built a database called Dynamo, and we wrote about that, and that was picked up everywhere in the world. And people started to understand what kind of engineering work was going on in Amazon. With the rise of the cloud computing division, everybody suddenly starts to understand that this is world-class engineering. Nobody operates at this scale. Yeah, if you look at the kind of things that have been built, for example, with Amazon S3, the simple storage service, is incredible. And everybody understands that if you build these services, these compute services and the database services and video transcoding and the search services and all of these, people start to understand what tremendous technology sits behind there. And so it's a lot easier to attract engineers these days than what it used to be. And so at the same time, we do have a lot of presence, for example, on campuses. Yeah, we do go a lot of campuses. There's recruiters on campus. There's people and also often bringing engineers from Amazon to those campuses to talk about their work. I don't know how it is here in Germany, but in the US, for example, you have job fairs at the university. Yeah, basically where potential employers come to talk about or to actually have sort of fairs where you can talk to different. We always make sure that the people at the job fairs are not just recruiters, maybe one recruiter, and then maybe five engineers. Just engineers that normally work on a daily basis at Amazon get to go to these job fairs. So that you actually can get, you know, the true story. What do we do to keep them? I like to believe that the stuff that we do at Amazon is totally outworldly. Yeah, this is stuff that happens nowhere else. And as such, I think we have pretty satisfied engineers. Also, what we do...
It must be that way, you know? Because when I visited you last time in Seattle, I saw the offices of most areas which we visited at that day. And you in Germany, you couldn't attract one talented person working in those kind of booths. And so it must be the world-class technology to keep the people.
But do you want us an engineer? You want a really good laptop? You know, who cares about the rest? you want a good coffee machine. You want enough Mountain Dew. Absolutely. Look, I have a fridge in my office. Yeah, it's full of green stuff. So often things that you don't notice on the outside is that from the technology, if you look at the engineering side of things, there isn't a particular, let's say, computer science area that is not represented somewhere within Amazon. Whether that is high volume transaction processing, whether that is machine learning, whether it's data analytics, whether it's robotics, whether it is AI, whether it's natural language processing, and everything at a scale that is probably not done anywhere. Not even in research in academia. This is beyond, we call it production, but many other situations might have been called research. The things that we do with machine learning, actually our machine learning lab is in Berlin. The guys interested in machine learning, that there's open jobs there. there's so many different things happening within Amazon. It also means we promote within Amazon for engineers, actually for all workers, to migrate within the company. So within a year, we ask you to be within a team at least a year. Yeah, and then after a year, year and a half, within the team, you're able to pick another team. So you might work on, let's say, order processing. In the order pipeline, you may work on technology there with new database models, with document model and things like that. And then you've worked on that for a year, year and a half, and you think it would be great to go do operational planning. Yeah, build software for how packages need to move through the warehouses. Yeah? And when you've done that, I think after a year or a year and a half or whatever, I would love to work on some of the more digital video streaming technologies. You move over to groups over there. So there is so much opportunities for engineers within Amazon to do very, very cool stuff that instead of leaving the company, they often move within the company because we have such a broad offering. The other thing is that I've told you earlier that we have engineers who also do operations. Yeah, so they have great experience in operating stuff at scale. And engineers that have worked at Amazon, let's say for 3-4 years, are often worth gold. Now, you'll be hunted down by recruiters from every possible company in the world, including every startup. Every startup would like to hire one or two Amazon engineers because the kind of experience that they have operating at scale reliably is worth gold. So you can triple your salary easily by, you know, starting off at Amazon.
That's great marketing. I just have to give you one remark I had today in my discussion with Oliver Zamba, who is in this country the founder of Rocket Internet. And he said about American companies, you know, at Google, you have 7 Jews in your juice machine, but you can come as to us. You have one juice, and then we build a huge platform together, and we win the world. The question is that what you're saying about Amazon? Is this a US-centric view, or do you think it's a global view? Because in America, what you're saying, it's reflected by the rankings. Students love to work for Amazon. If you look at Glassdoor, Amazon, it's precisely what you're saying, but it's not the situation here. Is this US-centric view or global view, what you say?
Well, first of all, I like to believe that we are, yes, of course, we're an American company, but we also operate in, we have customers in 190 countries around the world. Yeah, that means that you cannot work at Amazon and have a UX, US-centric view of everything. Yeah, I mean, I don't know what the percentage is, but a significant percentage of our revenue is coming from outside the US. And as such, you know, you have to be world-centric to be able to work well within Amazon. And I actually like to believe that us Europeans are really well suited to operate in such an environment. Here you drive 200 kilometers either west or east and you end up in a country with a different language. Yeah? This is something that we grew up with.
And that's true. From Bavaria to Austria, you're right.
Well, okay, good. But by the way, if you listen to the Austrians, it's almost a different language.
It is, absolutely. That's what I said.
Yeah, so, no, but what I mean is that in Europe, we grow up with, how many countries are now in the EU? 28? Yeah, so we if you just look at the EU, we have 28 different countries, 28 different cultures. And even within our countries, we have significant different cultures. And so this is something that we've grown up with. So we have a sensitivity for other cultures and for dealing with other cultures. And even at business level, understanding that there is different taxes in different countries and how to do business with different countries. If you come out of the US, often US entrepreneurs, definitely if you look at younger businesses, they have a hard time migrating from a US-centric business to a world business. Because for Europeans, it's easy to do business in Asia because you understand that there's many different cultures. Quite a few US entrepreneurs, I'm not saying Amazon executives, but just entrepreneurs in general, they start off with the idea that everything is like the US. And it's often shocking for them that that's not the case. Yeah, but for us Europeans, this is just a given. This is how you grew up. And as such, I think we're much better suited as Europeans to drive worldwide business.
Further questions?
I don't know the hard number, but it's between 40 and 50%. It's around that number, 40%, I think. We put out a press release at the end of each year. If you go to
the Amazon
press,
Inc.
Press release, if you go to the bottom of Amazon.com, there's a press room, and that actually has sort of documents with the absolute numbers. It's more than 40% from marketplace. So it's an increasingly important part of the Amazon business. Also because these third-party sellers help us with often, let's say, the long term, the long tail of products, yeah? Where Amazon.com may carry the most popular products, but there is an exclusivity in the long tail that often our third parties deliver. But it's an increasingly important part of it. And let me tell you, as you know, we do this cloud computing division, and you can tell long stories why we did that. But there's other things within Amazon that we've turned into a platform as well. One of them is called Fulfillment by Amazon, which means that, we're really good at shipping packages, yeah, and making sure they arrive on time, to handle returns and things like that. Third parties are often not that good at it, especially if they're a really smaller shop. Yeah, they love to sell, they hate to ship. Wrap up the package, you have to bring it to the post office, things like that. That is, and as such, looking at our feedback, our customer service feedback, a significant number of that feedback used to be about third parties not shipping on time. Yeah. And so what we decided to do is open up our fulfillment center so customers if you can use Fulfillment by Amazon, you can put your goods in our warehouses and we give you an interface and you can tell us ship that package somewhere else. You don't even need to sell on Amazon. Yeah, you can sell on eBay, but you can put your goods in the Amazon warehouses. Yeah, and so that's such a service that we offer. For our customers, for our sellers that do sell on the Amazon marketplace, if you put things in our warehouses, you become part of Prime. And so that means that our third parties now actually can be offered through the same mechanisms that Prime has. Many of our customers, especially those that are Prime members, we'll push that one button on the site when they search, which is can this be delivered by Prime? Now, in the first phase of Prime, those who are only Amazon our articles. But now it's actually also products offered by third parties that make use of fulfillment by Amazon from our warehouses, such that we can actually really guarantee that this is next day shipping or second day shipping.
The only challenge, Werner, we had lots of articles here in our media where companies, e-commerce companies, use these services and realized after they have been successful selling on Amazon's platform that your buying team went directly to the same producer, bought it in mass categories and killed the company instantly after two or three months after you introduced it then on your own platform with your own product.
I don't know about those stories, and it seems highly unlikely. No, there's no faster way to kill your platform than to behave like that.
Yeah.
It needs to be an absolute, if you build platforms, it needs to be an absolute level playing field. Yeah? You cannot give your own buyers, let's say, an advantage over your third-party sellers. There would be no, I mean, what reason would there be for third parties then to go sell on our platform?
Absolutely. And that's
I like to believe that there's more to that story than just us actually going after. It's the same thing in our cloud computing division. Yeah, you guys probably know Netflix. Oh, yeah. You have Netflix here?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
I just started.
Netflix runs also on AWS. So the two biggest competitors in the US in terms of video on demand are Amazon Video on Demand and Netflix. Both run on exactly the same platform. They both run on the Amazon web services. Yeah. We cannot secretly, somewhere in the code says, if Amazon, go left. If Netflix, go right. Yeah. That, no, you have to build, if you build platforms, they need to be absolutely democratic and egalitarian. You cannot give an advantage to any preferential treatment to any of your customers. That would be the end of your business immediately.
My feeling on that, let me comment on that topic. I totally can understand that fear, because if you see at the moment the revenue on certain business area, for example, Googly probably takes 2/3 of all global digital advertisement. And you have now a debate in Europe, and that debate was also only with Microsoft in Europe, that the companies have to be breaking up. And that discussion will come. And it won't come in America, because the American way of system, I think, is, you mustn't comment on that. There's a different way of thinking. In America, the greater the better, better for America. Where in Europe, we have seen that the EU Commission has been very tough, for example, on Microsoft to separate the browser from the operating system. And we had now, last year, already a discussion in the European Commission that Google has to be split up. There's a big discussion going on. Is it possible? Is it not possible? Between a neutral search and an advertising business. And I think that it is, you know,
some corrections. The US actually does act on anti-competitive behavior. Yeah, I mean, the big example is, of course, the split of AT&T into multiple business units because of monopolistic abuse. And I think this is all about monopolies. Amazon doesn't have a monopoly. There's no monopoly in e-commerce. No, I mean, at DLD, I've met at least four or five other even small business or middle-sized businesses that are operating in the e-commerce world that are usually successful. Now, and remember that e-commerce is a world where customers can easily move from one place to another. If you want to buy Nike shoes, you know, you'll go to another company than you would buy on Amazon. Plus, remember, there's this thing called brick-and-mortar stores. Yeah? There are still stores out there selling goods. You know, if you just walk through the streets here. And if I look at if I think about competition for Amazon, I think it is still the brick and mortar stores that are the competition. Yeah, and that's where you compete with. There is no equivalent of a search engine or of an operating system in the real physical world. So the world of Amazon is very different. And so Amazon doesn't have a monopoly at all. I mean,
you're much far away from where Google is right now. Definitely.
I think that's a very different business.
Yeah.
You know, in our case, I think we are so customer focused. Also because the way to grow our business still is to not actually eat into other e-commerce businesses, but to get more people from shopping on the streets to shopping online. I think that's, and in the US, I think, what is it? There is $6 trillion being spent each year still in brick and mortar businesses, just in regular stores. You know, Amazon has $70 billion in revenue or something like that. This is nowhere near, let's say, dominating the way that retail works.
But Werner, I mean, I can understand your remark you made. Just let me give you one data. We are here in Germany, we own Cyberport and Computer Universe, and they're two consumer electronics reseller. And we got data from Lenovo, which you know is a very large brand. And we have been for many years largest seller of Lenovo laptops in this country. And Amazon switched Lenovo on last year. And in the third quarter, according to the data, Amazon sold more laptops than we did with both companies in the whole year. So the question is not what are the brick and mortar companies doing, but is there afterwards only Amazon and then brick and mortar and that's it? And I think the thing,
look at the US. Companies like Adorama, like Crutchfield, they're all major e-commerce. First of all, they have their own brick and mortar stores, but they also have a significant online presence. And so those are equally companies that have a very successful business online. Best Buy, Sears, all these companies that used to be only online, that used to be only brick and mortar, now have very successful online businesses as well. In this world of e-commerce, as I said earlier, it's very easy to be disintermediated. Yeah? If we do not continue to innovate and drive innovation on behalf of our customers, within a number of years, we won't no longer be that big successful e-commerce company because other e-commerce company will rise to the top. And I think that's very easy to see how that would happen.
Okay. Just because we are running out of time, I just would like to bundle now the three hands. Just very fast a question, and then Werner will try to bundle it.
I actually think that most platforms, most formats are supported. And also, we have a number of converters that we can help you bring that back to the one format that we're using. So it's not that the device is actually limited to only have Amazon books on it. You can actually, I forgot what there's three main formats, I believe, there are. We make use of one, and there's two other formats. One of those formats you can put directly on the Kindle. The other one, you need to run it through a converter, and then you can also download it on the Kindle. Of course, you cannot download it through the wireless interface. You just have to plug your USB thing in your computer, but you can put your books on there. There's lots of books actually in the public domain, for example, in digital form, that you can just easily put directly onto the Kindle. That's not a technology point. It's actually the value of Bitcoin is so volatile.
Mm-hmm.
That it's pretty hard to actually use that as a currency. Yeah, have we thought about it? Yes, of course. We continue to think about it, but I think we would need to see more stability in the form of, because it's just another value. It's like, you know, we would transform it from Bitcoin into dollars immediately. Yeah, And as such, you know, I think at this moment, the price, let's say, it's pretty volatile. The Bitcoin.
Hopefully, you don't do the same with the euro in a year. Anyway, sorry for that remark. There was another hand here and here.
Well, the thing about, of course, using anonymous payments is something that, first of all, anonymous payments is something that we're very much used to. Everybody does this. Because if you go to a shop and you give someone money, that's basically an anonymous transaction. Yeah. Having sort of the equivalent of that is an interesting technology to think about. How would you implement that?
Yeah.
The technology by itself, let's say using encryption, And using these kind of chains are interesting technologies by themselves. Yes, absolutely. We are notoriously secretive about kind of stuff that we do in that direction.
Okay, time is up. Thank you very much for your questions, and thank you very much for joining us tonight.
Thanks.
And for the time here. It was great.